Welcome back at Evolutionary Psychology. The topic of today is Ramotarsing and Buikhuizen, Dutch Dogmas, Politics and Media, a case study. I want to present you two cases, one about Jurnus Ramotarsing, the other about Wouter Buikhuizen. I'll explain what they entail and what they have in common. I'll start with Jurnus Ramotarsing. He was a candidate for a seat in the Dutch parliament for the right-wing political party Forum for Democracy, meaning Forum for Democracy. In the end, he didn't get enough votes for his seat. Jurnus is a libertarian, pro-capitalist, and in some aspects a right-wing conservative thinker, but always an honest, creative and original one. Furthermore, he is a well-known YouTube vlogger. I don't agree with him on all his viewpoints, but his case on IQ disparities between countries and ethnic groups and the reaction on this by politicians and media says a lot on how a very important discussion is silenced even before it has really started. In this case it was in Holland, but in many more countries in the West we see the same patterns. And this concerns me a lot. I will tell you the story of Jurnus and of another Dutch scientist who was cancelled by the media for having the wrong ideas, meaning having ideas diverting from the dominant mainstream in a certain area. In summer 2016, on a national broadcast news net, the Suriname-born Jurnus said, "I wish it wasn't true, that black people were hyper-intelligent, that the people of Suriname had the highest IQ in the world, but that is simply not the case." Later, Jurnus made another claim on gay people having on average a higher IQ than non-gays. Giving gay people gay rights and the opportunity not to have biological children of their own would pull down the average IQ of our population. To be clear, I'll support him on his statements on the black-white IQ gaps. This is a well-researched and well-documented topic. I have told you about it in my last video on IQ testing and racism. But the claims on gays and IQ are not supported by solid empirical evidence. Furthermore, the sugar daddy hypothesis on gays makes clear why their genes are not being selected out. Not their genes for alleged intelligence and not their genes for homosexuality. The sugar daddy hypothesis claims that when uncles and aunts support the upbringing of their little cousins, these children have a bigger survival rate than do better in life compared to youngsters lacking these extra resources. Some of these sugar uncles and sugar aunts may be gays, and this mechanism explains for the fact that genes for homosexuality have not been selected out in evolution. If you want to know more about this topic, in some future episode of Evolutionary Psychology, I will dive deeper into this intriguing subject. But anyhow, the statement of Jurnus stirred some toxic excitement and anger in the Dutch media. Kaiser Ollongren, the Vice Prime Minister of the Netherlands and a member of D66, a left liberal party, called Forum for Democracy a threat to the state, as if we were talking about some terrorist organization planning a number of bloody bomber attacks. She didn't, however, refute Jurnus' arguments, nor did she present any counter-evidence or named any publication proving Jurnus wrong. Merely talking about race and ethnic groups in connection with IQ was enough for her to brand Jurnus as a racist. She also drew some unfounded and frankly rather absurd conclusions about people talking about groups scoring differently on IQ tests. Ollongren claims people like Jurnus automatically have the opinion these groups should be treated differently, should have less rights and are of less worth. Accusations of supporting eugenics, Nazism, social Darwinist policies were uttered again, without any shred of evidence. In short, no valid arguments and a lot of emotions, based on nothing more than her own prejudice. Intellectual laziness in its worst kind. Ollongren just tabooed the subject as something you should not speak of. And this is of course quite troubling for a member of our cabinet, putting some topics she personally doesn't like outside the realm of free speech and open investigation. Is she going to decide for scientists what to investigate and what to investigate not? I dearly hope not. Sometimes later, two other prominent politicians followed in her footsteps. Bode Asscher, leader of the Social Democrats, and Pechtold, leader of D66, came with the same unfounded accusations of racism. And just like Ollergren, they didn't support this with any arguments, facts or scientific data. Of course, for everyone it was clear the attacks were not primarily targeted at Ramanathar Singh himself, but were meant to cripple the party he belonged to and the party leader Thierry Baudet. In a political debate, Femke Halsema, the leader of the Green Party and current mayor of Amsterdam, attacked Baudet. He was accused of being the leader of a racist party. Being a bit overwhelmed by it, Baudet couldn't present all the facts at hand fast enough to denounce the accusations and was unable to simply explain why IQ is not the same as intelligence, let alone that IQ says anything about genetic differences between races or ethnic groups. And this hesitation made the damage irreparable. Baudet refused to denounce Ramanathar Singh, and the media had their minds made up, insofar they hadn't done that as long before, and found a weak spot to target on. In their discourse, Baudet, Ramanathar Singh and Forum for Democracy were all racist. To prevent further damage to the party, Jonas decided to withdraw, this meaning a premature end of a promising political career of this young libertarian. In the meantime, the subject caught attention of some other journalists, wanting to know what was really going on. They interviewed academics with in-depth knowledge of this complex subject. Two prominent Dutch experts on IQ and intelligence, Jan ten Nijenhuis and Fons van der Vijver, for example, had no other choice than to present the facts as known for decades to science. And these facts, say Ramanathar Singh, was not stating anything that was not true. The native Dutch population, for example, scores an average of 100 points on IQ tests, ten Nijenhuis explained. Immigrants from Morocco, Turkey, the Caribbean islands and Suriname show an average of 85 points, just as big a gap as the black-white gap in America. And descendants of Chinese immigrants score an average of 105 points. On top of the ranks, Dutch Jews, who go as high as an average of 112 points. So there are huge differences between the groups. And to a very high degree, they reflect on a broad range of life outcomes, like school performance, income, health, well-being, longevity, staying away from crime, welfare independency, stable marriages, and a lot of other positive statistics. IQ scores are the best predictors for job performance, and this applies to native Dutch people as well as for immigrants who had to learn the Dutch language later in life. The only point van der Vijver and ten Nijenhuis showed a slight difference of opinion on is how much IQ test is really telling something about the underlying construct of intelligence, something called the G factor. That which is a genetic trait and causes together with nurture, environment and training what is visible in IQ scores a person will be scoring on. I will explain this. When we talk about intelligence and IQ, we always have to be specific on precisely what we are discussing. In this picture, on the left, you see the G factor. Note, this is something invisible, something we infer it must exist, but which we cannot observe directly, something like an electron or light wave in physics. In the middle, we see clusters of skills, like verbal, V, and perceptual skills, P. On the right, there are the concrete individual tasks people are working on during an IQ test, and which are clearly visible in test scores. The reason why we infer the second and first layer is that a group of, let's say, verbal tasks show a very high correlation within that group. But also the cluster on the second level go together to a big extent. If someone is doing good at verbal tasks, there is a high chance he will do good at the perceptual and mathematical clusters as well. That's why science say there must be an even deeper common factor influencing the middle range clusters and the right range of tasks. This deeper factor we call G, for general, G factor, also known as intelligence. And this is the domain where nature, biology and genes play the first role. You can compare it to a talent for sports or music. Someone excellent at playing a piano may be mediocre at playing a horn, but he will learn it faster than someone with no talent for music at all. By only looking at how well a group of people is playing the piano, you get something like an IQ score made for a test in Holland. If immigrants never played piano, but only horns, and you test them by letting them play a piano, they will, as a group, will score not very high. If you, however, give them time, 5 years, let's say, to practice the piano, and test them again, you will still get differences within this group of immigrants. The highest scorers having the best musical talents, the G factor for intelligence, and they are the best candidates if you are looking for a professional piano player for an orchestra. So, what you measure is always a combination of nature and nurture, genes and practice. But, and this may surprise you, when you take the performance of the immigrants on the horn, they give a very accurate prediction on how well these immigrants will do on a piano 5 years later. The rank order on horn will also, to a very great extent, overlap with the rank order on piano. We call this talent for music, or in IQ terms, this is the G factor. Like we showed in the episode on IQ testing, you can use an IQ test to predict how well an individual will do in, let's say, the Dutch culture. On the level of groups, group score are a very good indicator to see how well a group has integrated into Dutch society. But it's not a good instrument to measure this mysterious G factor and draw conclusions about genetic differences between groups. In fact, up to this moment, we do not have a proper instrument to measure differences or similarity on this aspect. People who claim they have and use IQ results to say something about the G factor are deceiving you and maybe indeed can be viewed as racist. This doesn't mean, however, that minority groups living for a longer time in a country and were able to participate in a culture will by definition score the same as the dominant group does. Within the USA, we see huge differences between ethnic groups. These disparities may partly be caused by discrimination or segregation, but can also be caused by dysfunctional cultures, not taking opportunities offered, and other group internal factors, like skills of parents and lack of self-confidence, handed over from generation to generation. Connected to the story of Jurnes Ramo-Tarsing, I want to tell you what happened to Wouter Buikhuizen, a Dutch professor in criminology at the University of Groningen and Leiden. In the 70s and 80s, he wanted to research on biological factors in the behavior of young criminals. Specifically, he was curious if he could find differences in adrenaline and testosterone levels in criminal versus non-criminal adolescents. Something quite unusual at that time, where the mainstream line of thinking in social sciences was that behavior was fully determined by upbringing and socio-economical factors. So crime was no personal choice, had nothing to do with genes, and was in that view primarily caused by a capitalistic suppressing system. Criminals being sometimes celebrated as the rebels and heroes of our times, the ones daring to challenge the system of oppression. Buikhuizen was especially attacked by the powerful columnist of the magazine Vrij Nederland, Hugo Brandt Kostius. This is a very dogmatic left-wing writer. There is no fact, no research, no logical arguments that can change his opinion, and that is, biology in the social sciences is wrong. For Brandt Kostius, this was an unshakable truth. Even after some decades, most academics had to admit they were wrong about Buikhuizen. Brandt Kostius refused to denounce his rigid opinions. And of course, it wouldn't be any problem if he attacked Buikhuizen on the basis of fact, data and arguments. But he didn't. His prime means of discussing was attacking Buikhuizen as a person, as viciously as possible, for a long period of time, and inciting colleagues to do the same. So, no more than ordinary bullying like little kids do at school. He compared Buikhuizen with people like Lombroso, a 19th century pseudoscientist who thought skull size and skull forms would reveal everything about intelligence and personality, and with Mengele, the sadistic camp doctor who conducted the most horrible experiments on living human subjects. Buikhuizen appeared to be a visionary, being ahead of his time. In the 70s and 80s, he was vilified. Some years later, Anglo-American psychologists conducted the same research Buikhuizen was planning, and they discovered some strong relations between behavior and neurological features. Kloninger, for example, proved that the neurotransmitter dopamine is strongly related to sensation seeking. Serotonin appeared to be linked to avoidance behavior and a higher sensibility for punishment. Noradrenaline is connected with reward dependency, that is, the urge to do everything needed when you really want something. You can imagine that a certain profile of these substances leads to higher propensity to end in crime. However, this relation is never one-to-one. A certain kid growing up to be criminal, a kid with the same profile but living in another environment, in another family, with other opportunities, will grow out to be a great entrepreneur, heroic soldier, or a celebrated sportsman. But however visionary, Buikhuizen was bullied out of university and out of Holland. He ended up running a shop in antiques in Spain. So far for Holland, being known as the leading country for free speech, but not really. What is the common theme in these two stories? Well, I think you might have guessed it by now. It's all about the power of a certain dogma. A dogma that doesn't tolerate any open competition. A dogma that is afraid of discussion. It's the idea that all people have equal talents and disparities are caused by suppression by the dominant group. And that man is created by nurture and therefore nature cannot play any role in our behavior. It's the ridiculous idea that allowing biology into the social sciences will bring back racism, Mengele, eugenetics, and social Darwinism. It's an ideology afraid of open discussion, apparently not too sure about itself, and hardly that powerful as it used to present itself. It's the idea that man and society are fully malleable, that all people have equal talents and therefore are all disparities found, whether in IQ, income, or positions of power, are the result of suppression. In fact, that any problem can be attributed to people in power, a capitalistic structure, or vague things like systemic racism or white privilege. In some future video, I will dive deeper into this subject. But you may have noticed that a common theme on our videos on evolutionary psychology is in this constant battle between logic and rationality, versus this pervasive and non-scientific idea. Okay folks, enough for today. I hope you liked this video. If so, please don't forget to share, like, and subscribe.